So good morning, students. Now in this session, we'll have synopsis on the topic that is biotechnology and its applications. Okay. So in the previous chapter, we have seen the principles and processes. Now in this topic, we will see where exactly biotechnology is applied. Fine. So what is biotechnology dealing with? It deals with industrial scale production of various biopharmaceuticals, biologically using genetically modified organisms, maybe different types of microbes like fungi, bacteria, even higher organisms like plants, animals, etc. Its application includes therapeutics, diagnostics, GM, genetically modified crops for agriculture, processed food, bioremediation, waste management, energy production, etc. And as we all can recall, there are three critical research areas of biotechnology. And number one is providing the best catalyst in the form of improved organism. And it usually is a microbe or even sometimes it can be an enzyme also. Creating optimal conditions through engineering for a catalyst to act. And lastly, downstream processing technologies to purify the protein or it can be any organic compound. So these are the three critical research areas. Using this, we can go for application in various sectors. Okay, now coming to the next part, that is biotechnological applications in agriculture. Okay, children, food production basically can be increased by various techniques, okay, or various methods. One of them, three are mentioned here. One is agrochemical based agriculture, in which you can make use of various chemical fertilizers or chemical pesticides, and by which you can enhance or increase the food production. Second one is organic agriculture, where you are restricting yourselves to the usage of biofertilizers, biopesticides, manure, etc. And thirdly is genetically engineered crop based agriculture, where you depend on the usage of genetically modified organisms or specifically genetically modified crops to increase the yield. So these are the three basic pillars by which food production can be enhanced. Another thing to be remembered is green revolution. We are quite aware of this terminology, green revolution, and this green revolution has succeeded in tripling the food supply. But thing is, yet it was not enough to feed the growing human population. Okay. Increased yields were due to what factors? They were due to certain factors like use of improved crop varieties, you say, and mainly it was due to the use of better management practices, agrochemicals, like, as I said, fertilizers and pesticides, etc. However, if you take, when you talk about the developing countries, like our own country, agrochemicals will be expensive to the farmers, and further increase in yield with the already existing varieties is very difficult and sometimes not possible only using conventional breeding methods. Okay. So to overcome this problem, now we have to switch to usage of genetically modified crops. Okay. To increase the further production, we have to depend upon the GMOs, and genetically modified plants have many applications actually. They have been developed for many purposes, like some are mentioned here, like they made crops more tolerant to abiotic stress, like this different kind of stress you take, like drought, salt, salinity, or heat or cold, etc. Even reduce reliance on chemical pesticides, means you can reduce dependability on chemical pesticides by using GMOs, by making plants resistant to pests. Okay. And even it has helped to reduce the post-harvest losses. One very good example you have learned in this chapter, that is tomato flavor saver, which can reduce the post-harvest loss. Even they have increased the efficiency of mineral usage by plants, and this prevents basically early exhaustion of fertility of soil. And another very important thing is GMOs have helped in enhancing nutritional value of foods, like vitamin A enriched rice is a very good example, okay, which is enriched with beta carotene synthesizing genes. Okay, so these are the different applications where genetically modified plants are explored. Now coming to applications of biotechnology in the production of pest resistant plants. Okay. One important example we have studied, children, if you just remember, that is the usage of BT toxin. Okay. So pest resistant plants are those which decrease the amount of pesticides used in the agriculture field. And for this, we depended on one bacterium, that is Bacillus thuringiensis. And this bacterium is producing a toxin. And this toxin is produced by a gene, okay, that is called as cry gene, basically, or BT toxin human gene. This gene has been cloned from the bacteria and has been expressed in various plants to provide resistance to insects without the need of insecticides. Okay, so this, like this, we could develop different types of resistant plants. Like you take BT cotton, BT corn, BT rice, tomato, potato, soybean, etc. Okay, so what is this BT cotton? As per your syllabus, you have studied in detail about this BT cotton, children. And as I said, you, Bacillus thuringiensis organism is used here. This is basically a soil bacterium which is naturally producing a toxin or protein, I should say, that will kill certain insects such as lepidopterans you take, or coleopterans, or even diopterans. Okay, and how this is possible is it produces protein crystals during a particular phase of its lifespan or particular phase of its growth. Which phase is not mentioned? Actually, you should also know that that is nothing but during sporulation phase it produces this protein crystals. Okay, and these crystals contain a toxic insecticidal protein. And very important thing is this protein which is produced by this bacterium, children, it is existing in an inactive state, what we call as inactive prototoxin. But once the insect ingests that inactive toxin, it will be converted into an active form due to the alkaline pH of the gut, as we all know that. And due to this alkaline pH, the toxin will be solubilized. Okay, the crystal will be solubilized and toxin will be activated. Once the toxin gets activated, it binds to the surface of midgut epithelial cells and helps to create pores. And these pores are very dangerous, which causes cell swelling and ultimately lysis, and ultimately leading to the death of the insect. So this is the mechanism how actually the protein will act on the insects and ultimately kills it. Okay, and the gene from BT has been incorporated into several crops, like even as I mentioned earlier also, now cotton, maize, rice, etc. And one important thing is there are different set of genes which are coding for different set of proteins which are active on different set of insects. That is very important. For example, the protein coded by genes Cry1AC and Cry2AB control the cotton boll worms, whereas Cry1AB is used to control the corn borer. So in this way, pest resistant plants have been developed using agrobacterium vectors only, children, and BT cotton was successfully developed. Now we have another concept in this chapter, that is the pest resistant plants. Herein we use a different technique. Okay, and one example what is mentioned is with respect to nematodes. So nematodes, particularly Melodigyne incognitia, is known to infect the roots of tobacco plant and causes reduction in yield, and it causes a disease. Actually, the name of that disease is root knot disease, children. And the infestation of these nematodes is prevented by a new technique that is called as RNA interference. So what is RNA interference? Basically, you must know it is a phenomenon that exists only in eukaryotes as a cellular defense mechanism, and it helps to silence a specific mRNA due to the complementary double stranded RNA molecules that bind to and prevent its translation. Very important, it is found only in eukaryotes. The purpose is cellular defense. And how it happens? It silences a specific mRNA, okay, due to the binding of a complementary double-stranded RNA and ultimately preventing the translation of the specific mRNA. And now, what is the source of that complementary dsRNA? It can be anything. It can be from an infection by a virus which have RNA genomes. It can be from mobile genetic elements, like you take transposons also, which are known to replicate via RNA intermediates. So viruses can be one source, even mobile. Transposons also can help to produce this double-stranded RNA. And the technique was used to develop resistance in tobacco using the same bacterium, that is agrobacterial vectors, that is nothing but the TI plasmid only, children. Nematode-specific genes actually were introduced into the host plant, and the introduction of DNA was such, this very important, introduction was done in such a way that it produced both the sense and antisense RNA in the host cells. And these two RNAs definitely will be complementary to each other, and they form a double-stranded structure that is known to initiate interference. So ultimately silencing the specific mRNA of the pathogen. I hope you are understanding. Nematode specific genes were introduced. Only thing you have to remember is the genes were introduced in such a way that they produced complementary RNAs. That means both the sense and antisense strands were introduced, okay, very important. And hence, when sense and antisense transfer introduced, definitely double stranded RNA will form, and this double stranded RNA will initiate the process of interference and hence silence the mRNA of the nematode. Okay, this is important. In this way, the plant will get itself protected from the parasite by interfering RNA. So this was one method which was used against Meliodigyne incognitia. Now we have another concept in this chapter, that is biotechnological applications in medicine. In that there are different therapeutics or medicines which are developed by biotechnology as a science. The recombinant therapeutics actually which were developed at present, if you talk about, 30 recombinant therapeutics have been approved for human use all over the world actually, and India 12 of these are presently being marketed. Okay, this is as per your NCRT data, but further updates are available on net. Okay, this data actually is an old data, children. To get yourself updated, you have to keep on referring to the latest literature, also very important, as I used to tell you multiple times. Okay, now when you come to the genetically engineered insulin, which you have studied as a subtopic here. So what is insulin? You all know that it's a hormone, okay, pancreatic hormone, protein hormone, basically known for regulating the blood sugar level. And adult onset diabetes can be controlled by taking insulin at regular intervals. Okay, in earlier days, the main source of this insulin were animals, particularly the cattle and pigs, where when they were slaughtered, the insulin was isolated from the slaughtered animals from the pancreas. Okay, but there was a problem that this insulin used to create some allergic reactions in the body of the persons, as well as one other problem was that insulin was actually not sufficient also. So there were the two major problems, children. So to overcome this problem, biotechnology has helped a lot, and today we are able to produce large quantities of insulin at a large scale. That too, we are able to produce human insulin, exactly, not the animal insulin, human insulin, which has no chances of causing any allergic responses, and the quantity also is not a problem right now. And how this was possible? Only because of biotechnology or genetic engineering. And when you come to the structure of insulin, actually, this insulin consists of two short polypeptides, which are called a chain A and chain B, children. Okay, chain A and chain B, and these two are linked together by disulfide bridges. Okay, there are two disulfide bonds here. You can see in this structure, A peptide and B peptide, two disulfide bonds between A and B, and one disulfide bond within the A chain. Okay, within the A chain, very important. Okay, and here. In humans, this insulin is synthesized as a prohormone, which consists of an extra stretch, which is called a C-peptide, which is absent in mature insulin. It means that this C-peptide is removed during the maturation of insulin. Very important. And the main challenge for the production of insulin using RDNA technique was getting insulin assembled into a mature form. And the first of its kind, the one company that is called as Eli Lilly, an American company, in 1983, prepared two DNA sequences which were corresponding to A chain and B chain respectively. And these two separate sequences were introduced into the plasmids of E. coli to produce separate chains like A and B. Okay, these chains were produced and they were separately extracted and they were purified, and ultimately they were combined to create disulfide bonds to form mature human insulin, which was also called as humulin. Okay, so this was done by Eli Lilly, and after that also today, if you see, there are many companies which are able to synthesize this insulin artificially using E. coli as a host system. Okay, E. coli as a host system using suitable plasmids, like you take PBR, even series of PUC plasmids also can be used, and now it has become very easy to collect insulin at a large scale, as I said you. So this is one thing you have studied in this chapter. Now coming to the next concept, that is gene therapy, children. So what is this gene therapy? We know that there are many hereditary diseases and for which treatment is not available. Now, gene therapy is an attempt to provide help to such people. What is gene therapy exactly? It is a collection of methods that actually allows correction of a gene defect which has been diagnosed, even in children, or even it can be in embryo also. Okay, desirable or normal genes are inserted into the person's cells to treat that disease. Okay, and this correction of genetic defect involves delivery of a normal gene okay, into an individual or embryo to take over the function of the non-functional or the defective gene. I hope you are understanding. We are introducing a normal gene into the body of the person, or even at embryonic stages also it is possible to overtake or to take over the function and compensate for the non-functional gene. So the first of its kind, the first clinical gene therapy was done in 1990 to a 4-year-old girl who was suffering from ADA deficiency, that is nothing but adenosine deaminase deficiency. And this disorder or this problem is caused due to the deletion of the gene for ADA, that is adenosine deaminase, okay, that is essential for immune system to function. And children, you must know that it leads to a disease that is called as SCID, not mentioned actually in NCERT, SCID, okay, SCID, severe combined immunodeficiency. And that in SCID, what happens, the person will have weak immunity, immunity problems will develop because both the humoral as well as cell mediated immunity will be impaired due to this ADA deficiency because lymphocytes are not able to function properly. So this defect can be treated by enzyme replacement therapy, in which functional ADA is given to the patient by injection. Okay, you are giving enzyme replacement, okay, you are replacing the enzyme. Instead of gene, you can even provide a ready-made enzyme to the person, okay, ready-made ADA, which is given by injection, or even you can go for bone marrow transplant so that the defective lymphocytes can be allowed to take over, healthy lymphocytes can be allowed to take over the defective lymphocytes, and the healthy lymphocytes will produce the normal ADA. That is also an option. But in gene therapy method, what was done, lymphocytes from the blood of the patient were collected. They were grown in culture medium outside the body. And in those lymphocytes, a functional ADA cDNA, complementary DNA for this ADA gene, was introduced into these lymphocytes using retroviral vectors. Okay, which vectors were used? Retroviruses were used for this experiment. And with the help of these vectors only, they were further returned or injected back into the patient's body. So in this method, the patient is allowed to produce the healthy lymphocytes. Okay, now because the lymphocytes are genetically modified, functional gene is added to them, so they will start producing the enzyme ADA. So in this method, periodic infusion of such genetically engineered lymphocytes is needed because these lymphocytes, they are not actually immortal. These lymphocytes are mortal. They are not immortal, means they are mortal. I'm repeating, they are mortal. That's the reason the patient requires periodic infusion. However, sometimes if the gene isolate from marrow cells producing ADA is introduced into cells at embryonic stage, okay, in that case, it can be a permanent cure for that particular patient. So this is one thing you must remember. Even it can be done in the early embryonic stages. Now, we have another concept in this chapter, that is molecular diagnosis. So molecular diagnosis, okay, identifying a particular disease. There were many conventional methods of diagnosis, like you take blood testing, serum analysis, urine testing, etc., etc. Early detection with these conventional methods is not possible. That's the reason now we have to depend on some advanced techniques like RDNA technology, PCR, or ELISA, that is nothing but enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. Okay, symptoms of the disease appear only when the concentration of pathogen get increased significantly, and the low concentration of bacteria and virus can be detected by the amplification by the method PCR. Okay, so it detects a mutation in the gene in cancer patient. PCR can also be used routinely to detect the HIV in suspected persons. Okay, and even genetic disorder can also be detected by using PCR technique. That is a very, very powerful method, PCR as such, applicable in various analysis today. Okay, apart from that, we can even depend on usage of probes. Okay, probe can be single stranded DNA or RNA, which is usually tagged with radioactive molecule, and it is allowed to hybridize to its complementary DNA in a clone of cells, followed by detection actually using autoradiography. So this is one method, children. ELISA is one method. What is ELISA? ELISA is actually a test which is based on the principle of antigen antibody interaction. Okay, so in ELISA you are able to detect minute quantities of what antibodies, even you can detect antigens. Okay, so you can detect, there are different types of ELISA. If you just remember what you have learned, direct ELISA, indirect ELISA, also called as sandwich ELISA, etc. So ELISA is one very important technique nowadays used for the identification of HIV. Even it is used for detection of many different bacterial diseases also. Okay, because ultimately you can detect both the things, antibodies also as well as antigens also for the respective pathogen. So these are the various techniques for molecular diagnosis. Now another thing what you have in this chapter is transgenic animals, children. So what are transgenic animals? Animals that have had their DNA manipulated actually to possess and express a foreign gene are known as transgenic animals. We have many different types of transgenic animals like rabbits, pigs, rats, cows, etc., etc. Okay, and 95% of the transgenic animals, existing one, are mice. Okay, and there are many purposes why transgenic animals have to be produced. Like number one, normal physiology and development. If you want to study the normal physiology and development, definitely these studies will be helped, or these studies can be aided with the help of transgenic animals. Okay, like one example, insulin like growth factor mentioned in the NCRT textbook. Insulin-like growth factor that is mentioned. So, when you study the functioning of this insulin-like growth factor, you can know, okay, how the animal is responding to the normal growth attributes. Okay. Another one is study of diseases. Number of transgenic animals will be designed to increase our understanding of how genes contribute to development of diseases. Like transgenic model has been developed for diseases like cancer, you take cystic fibrosis, Alzheimer's disease, etc. Okay, today models are existing for all these different human diseases, like as I said, you cancer and all, even rheumatoid arthritis also. Even transgenic animals can be used as a source of biological products. One very good example, that is production of alpha-1 antitrypsin. Okay, and this is used to treat emphysema. That is one very good example. Another one is the first transgenic cow, okay, which was produced in the year 1997, okay, and the name was Rosie. It produced human protein enriched milk, that is human alpha lactalbumin, and the quantity was 2.4 grams per liter. Okay, and the milk contained this protein, and which was nutritionally more balanced actually, and can be used for human babies also to feed the human babies. This milk can be used because it is rich in human protein. Like that, similar attempts were made for the treatment of different diseases. Like you take phenylketonuria, cystic fibrosis, and all, you can produce products to treat this disorders. Okay, so this is also one concept. And we have vaccine safety and chemical safety testing. Transgenic mice are used for the testing of safety of vaccine before they are used on humans. Like polio vaccine was tested on transgenic mice and then on monkeys also. And if these tests are successful and if they are found to be reliable, then we could think of replacing them with the use of monkeys to test the safety of the batches of different vaccines. Okay, that means we can go for further level of studies when you are using a transgenic mice or any kind of transgenic animals. Similarly, we have chemical safety testing, and this also called as toxicity or safety testing, children. Similar to vaccine safety testing, wherein animals are made that carry genes which make them more sensitive actually. What is the purpose is we design the animals in such a way that they are made more sensitive to toxic substances. Purposely we do that than the non-transgenic animal. Then we are conducting research or studies on them by exposing them to a toxic substance, and then the results will be analyzed. So toxicity testing in such animals will help us to allow results, different levels of results, different types of results, particularly in the less time. So this is one advantage of using transgenic animals. Now the last concept in this chapter, what you have studied is ethical issues, children. So ethical standards are very important, and they are always required to evaluate the morality of human activities. Particularly in biotechnology, if you go beyond the morality, it leads to different issues. And the biological significance of such studies is also very important. Okay, and genetic modification of organism have some unpredictable results. Very important thing is, when you modify an organism genetically, you cannot predict what is the outcome. When such organisms, suppose they are released or introduced into the natural ecosystem, there may be many hazards associated with them. That's the reason always it is necessary to have some guidelines or to have some regulations. So the Indian government has set up organization like GEAC, okay, which will make decisions regarding the validity of GM research, safety of introducing GM organism for public services, etc. Okay. And it also gives permissions for the release of organisms, etc. So multiple functions are carried out by this particular committee. And another thing here is biopatent, what you have studied in this particular chapter. Okay, so what is this biopatent or patent? Basically, a biopatent is nothing but is the right granted by a government to an inventor, or and it prevents the other people from making commercial use of this invention. Different patents are granted for biological entities also. Even you can have a patent on a whole organism, you can have a patent on one enzyme, you can have a patent on one process, okay, and even product also, which are derived from biological resources. So once you have a patent, there will be no danger of piracy that is associated with that. That is the advantage. Okay, like in this biopiracy, one example here. So what is biopiracy? First of all, it is nothing but biopiracy is the term used to refer to the use of bioresources by MNCs and other organizations without proper authorization. You are not giving any authorization from the countries and the people concerned to your study, and neither you are giving any compensatory payment to them. This is called as piracy. Okay, and many examples you have studied. One very good example what you have studied is rice. Okay, we all know rice, very important food grain in India and other Asian countries also, and it is said that there are estimated 2 lakh varieties of rice in India alone, and there are nearly 27 documented varieties of basmati with different flavor and aroma, which are grown in India alone. Okay, so this patent, in 1997, an American company got a patent rights on basmati rice through the US Patent and Trademark Office. So what was that patent? The new variety of basmati actually was derived from Indian farmers varieties. Okay, and how it was derived was, it was only crossed with one of the semi dwarf varieties, and then it was claimed that it is a new invention or something new. Okay, and the patent which was granted, it extends to functional equivalence, and it says that other people who are selling basmati rice could be restricted by the patent. So this has raised several issues in India, and several attempts have been made to block this patent actually, and later the patent was withdrawn also, children, as you can remember we have discussed. And not only with respect to rice, several attempts have also been made to patent uses like you know, some Indian traditional herbal medicines which depend on usage of turmeric, neem, etc. Okay, so on these also patents were made, and later many of the patents were withdrawn also. Even what do you say, even patents were developed on the brinjal, okay, your nutritional value, even bitter gourd, anti-diabetic properties of bitter gourd. Okay, so multiple patents were granted later on after blocking this, after raising concerns over this, these patents were withdrawn, and finally now the Indian Parliament has recently cleared the amendment on one bill that is called as Indian Patents Bill. And this bill is very important because it considers issues related to patent terms, emergency provisions, and research and developmental initiatives, and these kind of things will be brought under control. So these are the highlights we have seen on the chapter that is biotechnology and its applications. Thank you.